see the King of glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. Oh, I see his love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart and make me clean. Open my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me.
Welcome to St. Anne's Church as we celebrate the Mass of Palm Sunday.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prayed, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today, we gather to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus and the disciples drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass untethered and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them here to me. And if anyone should say anything to you, reply, 'The master has need of them.' Then he will send them at once." This happened so that what had been spoken through the prophet might be fulfilled. "Say to daughter Zion, behold, your king comes to you, meek and riding as on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." The disciples went and did as Jesus had ordered them. They brought the ass and the colt and laid their cloaks over them, and he sat upon them. The very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and strewed them on the road. The crowds preceding him, and those following kept crying out and saying, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken and asked, "Who is this?" And the crowds replied, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
Please join us for our opening hymn, "Hosanna, Open the Gates."
Almighty, ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed this his lesson of patient suffering and so mercifully share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a well-trained tongue, that I may know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ears that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned my back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard, my face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm is Psalm 22, My God, My God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something that he should be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found in human appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. One of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you willing to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that time on, he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples approached Jesus and said,
"Where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover?"
He said,
"Go into the city to a certain man and tell him, 'The teacher says, my appointed time draws near. In your house I shall celebrate the Passover with my disciples.'"
The disciples then did as Jesus had ordered and prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he reclined at the table with the 12, and while they were eating, he said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me."
Deeply distressed at this, they began to say to him after another,
"Surely it is not I, Lord."
He said in reply,
"He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me is the one who will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
Then Judas, his betrayer, said in reply,
"Surely it is not I, Rabbi."
He answered,
"You have said so."
While they were eating, Jesus took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and giving it to his disciples, said,
"Take and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying,
"Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed on behalf of many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, from now on, I shall not drink this fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it with you new in the kingdom of my Father."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"This night all of you will have your faith in me shaken, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be dispersed.' But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him in reply,
"Though all may have their faith in you shaken, mine will never be."
Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me three times."
Peter said to him,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And all the disciples spoke likewise. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I go over there and pray."
He took along Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and began to feel sorrow and distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and keep watch with me."
He advanced a little and fell prostrate in prayer, saying,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, What is your will?
When he returned to his disciples, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
So you could not keep watch with me for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing a second time, he prayed again.
My Father, if it is not possible that this cup pass without my drinking it, your will be done.
Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open. He left them and withdrew again and prayed a third time, saying the same thing again. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them,
Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Behold, the hour is at hand when the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. Look, my betrayer is at hand.
While he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a large crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests and the elders of the people. His betrayer had arranged a sign with them, saying,
The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him.
Immediately he went over to Jesus and said,
Hail, Rabbi!
And he kissed him. Jesus answered him,
Friend, do what you have come for.
Then, stepping forward, they laid hands on Jesus and arrested him. And behold, one of those who accompanied Jesus put his hand to his sword, drew it, and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to him,
Put your sword back into its sheath, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot call upon my Father, and he will not provide me at this moment with more than 12 legions of angels? But then, how would the scriptures be fulfilled, which say that it must come to pass in this way?
At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds,
Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I sat teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me. But all this has come to pass, that the writings of the prophets may be fulfilled.
Then all the disciples left him and fled. Those who had arrested Jesus led him away to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the high priest's courtyard. And going inside, he sat down with the servants to see the outcome. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain false testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. Finally, two came forward who stated,
This man said, I can destroy the temple of God within 3 days.
The high priest rose and addressed him.
Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?
But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him,
I order you to tell us under oath before the living God whether you are the Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus said to him in reply,
You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his robes and said,
He has blasphemed. What further need have we of witness? You have now heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?
They said in reply,
He deserves to die.
Then they spat in his face and struck him, while some slapped him, saying,
Prophecy for us, Christ.
Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. One of the maids came over to him and said,
You too were with Jesus the Galilean.
But he denied it in front of everyone, saying,
I do not know what you're talking about.
As he went out to the gate, another girl saw him and said to those who were there,
This man was with Jesus as a Nazarene.
Again, he denied it with an oath.
I do not know the man.
A little later, some bystanders came over and said to Peter,
even your speech gives you away.
At that, he began to curse and to swear,
I do not know the man.
And immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus had spoken. Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times. He went out and began to weep bitterly. When it was morning, all the chief priests and the elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. They bound him, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
I have sinned in betraying innocent blood.
They said,
What is that to us? Look to it yourself.
Flinging the money into the temple, he departed and went off and hanged himself. The chief priests gathered up the money, but said,
It is not lawful to deposit this in the temple treasury, for it is the price of blood.
After consultation, they used it to buy the potter's field as a burial place for foreigners. That is why that field even today is called the field of blood. Then was fulfilled what had been said through Jeremiah the prophet. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the value of a man with a price on his head, a price set by the Israelites, and they paid it out for the potter's field, just as the Lord had commanded me. Now Jesus stood before the governor, Pontius Pilate, and he questioned him.
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus said,
You say so.
And when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he had made no answer. Then Pilate said to him,
Do you not hear how many things they are testifying against you?
But he did not answer him one word, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, on the occasion of the feast, the governor was accustomed to release to the crowd one prisoner whom they wished. And at the time, they had a notorious prisoner named Barabbas. So when they had assembled, Pilate said to them,
Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus called Christ?
For he knew that it was out of envy that they had handed him over. While he was seated on the bench, his wife sent him a message. Have nothing to do with that righteous man. I suffered much in a dream today because of him. The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas, but to destroy Jesus. The governor said to them in reply,
Which of the two do you want me to release to you?
They answered,
Barabbas.
Pilate said to them,
Then what shall I do with Jesus called Christ?
They all said,
Let him be crucified.
But he said,
Why? What evil has he done?
They only shouted the louder,
Let him be crucified.
When Pilate saw that he was not succeeding at all, but that a riot was breaking out instead, he took water, washed his hands in the sight of the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. Look to it yourselves.
And the whole people said in reply,
His blood be upon us and upon our children.
Then he released Barabbas to them. But after he had Jesus scourged, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus inside the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped off his clothes and threw a scarlet military cloak around him. Weaving a crown out of thorns, they placed it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
They spat upon him and took the reed and kept striking him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him off to be crucified. As they were going out, they met a Cyrenian named Simon. This man they pressed into service to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull, they gave Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall. But when he had tasted it, he refused to drink. After they had crucified him, they divided his garments by casting lots. Then they sat down and kept watch over him there. As they placed over his head the written charge against him, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and the other on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying,
"You who destroyed the temple and rebuilt it in 3 days, save yourself, if you are the Son of God, and come down from the cross."
Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him and said,
"He saved others, he did not save himself, so he is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him if he loves him, for he said, 'I am the Son of God.'"
The revolutionaries who were crucified with him also kept abusing him in the same way. From noon onward, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Some of the bystanders who heard it said,
"This one is calling for Elijah."
Immediately one of them ran to get a sponge. He soaked it in wine, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. But the rest said,
"Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to save him."
But Jesus cried out again in a loud voice and gave up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, rocks were split, tombs were opened, and the bodies of many saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming forth from their tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. The centurion and the man with him who were keeping the watch over Jesus feared greatly when they saw the earthquake and all that was happening. They said,
"Truly, this is the Son of God."
There were many women there, looking on from a distance, who had followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of the sons of Zebedee. When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was himself a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be handed over. Taking the body, Joseph wrapped it in a clean linen and laid it in his new tomb that he had hewn in the rock. Then he rolled a huge stone across the entrance to the tomb and departed. But Mary Magdalene and the other Mary remained sitting there, facing the tomb. The next day, the one following the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said,
"Sir, we reprehend that this impostor, while still alive, said, 'After 3 days, I will be raised up.' Get orders to the men that he grave be secured until the third day, lest his disciples come stealing him and save the people. He has been raised from the dead. This last impostor would be worse than the first."
Pilate said to them,
"The guard is yours. Go, secure it as best you can."
So they went and secured the tomb by fixing a seal to the stone and setting the guard. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to
you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Over the last few weeks, in the attempt to deal with the challenge of the coronavirus, we've heard a lot about medical professionals challenging us all to engage in disciplined hand washing and disciplined social distancing and curtailing our typical engagement and activities with others, all of it about flattening the curve. We've heard that phrase over and over again, a phrase that a couple of weeks ago simply was not in our common figures of speech. We've come to learn, of course, how important it is that these efforts that we undertake sacrificially will allow for the intensity of the virus to be spread out over time rather than highly focused in one very intense period of time that would risk overwhelming the ability to respond medically to this need. Strikes me as rather interesting. This is the most unique Holy Week that we will ever have together, probably. And on this Passion Sunday, Palm Sunday of the Lord's Passion, spiritually, we're not exactly flattening the curve. In fact, the curve spiritually intensifies. Beginning today, we enter into the most intense, spiritual, prayerful period of time throughout the whole year. The good news for us is that this intense period is different than the medical intensity that we're trying to avoid. This spiritual intensity is not destructive, hurtful, harmful, but rather constructive, growth-producing, and developmental in nature. The more that we immerse ourselves intensely, prayerfully, deeply into these coming days, then the more powerful will be the great joy and the proclamation that we will share together come Easter and the great 50 days following of the power of Jesus' victory over sin and death in his resurrection from the dead. Palm Sunday, our prayer today attempts, encourages us to become even more intense, not less intense, with the spiritual realities that are at the core of who we are as disciples of Jesus. And speaking of disciples of Jesus, there is perhaps among many powerful lines in today's Passion Proclamation from Matthew's Gospel, one particular line that I think is absolutely stunning. The narrator says, "Then all the disciples left him and fled." All the disciples left him and fled. Can you imagine what life would be like if all of the first responders and all of the medical professionals around us these days simply left us and fled? We would be in a horrible and terrible position. How horrible would it be if we, as disciples of Jesus today, were to simply abandon him, leave him, flee, walk away? Now, in fact, not exactly all of the disciples did. Certainly, when Jesus needed their support and their care and their presence the most, key disciples did. Peter, James denies him. James, John become invisible. Judas buys him off for his own personal profit. And most of the rest of the apostles are simply nowhere to be found when Jesus needs them the most. Contrast that with other disciples, other followers. Simon of Cyrene lends a hand to a struggling Jesus. Martha and Mary, the sisters of Lazarus, they're still there with him. Mary, Jesus' mother, still there with him. Other women who are witnesses are still there. Not everybody fled, but a lot did, right when he needed it the most. This Holy Week is all about not fleeing. It's all about being immersed in running toward Jesus, even more closely, even more deeply than we may have ever done before in our lives. It's a great thing about Christian faith. It is never too late to turn fully and more deeply toward Jesus who dwells within and among us. So we pray this day that our Palm Sunday prayer will help us not to diminish the intensity of this spiritual moment. We don't want to flatten this spiritual curve at all. We want to grow it, heighten it, and strengthen it so that the power, the great power that we will be celebrating in these coming days will in fact become even more fully operative in our minds and hearts and spirits as we seek to be that disciple, that community of disciples who does not flee or abandon Jesus, but walks and runs and moves always closer and deeper to him. Together we profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, men, and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. My brothers and sisters, we now turn to the Lord with confidence, praying for our needs and the needs of the whole world as we respond in song.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the church, that all who minister in the Lord's name may help us to live as servants of Christ who follow him in faith and love.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For more young people to happily and generously share the gifts and their talents of their lives in a church ministry as priests, deacons, and religious brothers and sisters.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For our catechumens and candidates preparing for the sacraments of initiation, may they know ever more deeply the Lord and his covenant of love in their hearts and spirits.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all nations and peoples of the world, may all who are suffering from the virus pandemic find healing, and may all the civic leaders, medical professionals, and first responders find strength and wisdom in guiding the human family through this difficult time.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For the continued growth and development of our partner parish of St. Clair in Haiti, especially in our efforts to provide food for their littlest angels.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For the safety and protection of all who serve in our nation, at home and far away.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are ill and who suffer in any way, and for those on St. Anne's Prayer Network, may the Lord's compassionate love bring them comfort, courage, and strength.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially all victims of the virus pandemic, and for those who mourn their passing, may the Lord God wipe away the tears from every face and strengthen them with a new hope.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
For Barbara Caper, Bill Hunt, and St. Anne parishioners, whom we remember at this Mass, and for the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts.
Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious and loving God, hear us as we pray. Help us to enter into this Holy Week with hearts and spirits newly opened and strengthened to follow Jesus as truly loyal and faithful disciples. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
who comes in the name of the Lord. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Blessed is he who comes. Baruch haba b'shem Adonai. Who comes in the name of the
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may the reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that just as though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness, make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more, giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The Mystery of Faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Please join our communion hymn, Shalom Jerusalem.
May his praise be full.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we conclude our prayer this morning, just a word of gratitude to all who have helped to make our prayer this day possible. We're really glad that through the marvelous means of modern technology, we can all be together today, if not physically, certainly in mind, heart, and spirit, as one prayerful community in the Lord Jesus. We really encourage you to make this week a very holy week, despite the challenge of dealing with the virus pandemic. This will still be a holy week for us, and I suspect very likely it will have a spiritual power unlike most other holy weeks we've all experienced. So to help tap into that, we really encourage you to join us tomorrow evening for a very special event at 7 o'clock in the evening, our Lent by Candlelight, featuring a prayerful reflection on the seven last words of Christ that begins tomorrow at 7 o'clock in the evening. And then, if you can join us for morning mass as well on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, 8 a.m. live streamed here on our Facebook page, and continue with morning prayer on Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday mornings, and then the great Triduum liturgies of the Mass of the Lord's Supper, Thursday evening, 7 o'clock, the Lord's Passion, Friday evening at 7 o'clock, and the great Easter Vigil of the Lord's Resurrection, Saturday at 8 o'clock, and of course, Easter Sunday morning, Mass at 9 a.m. Tremendously wonderful menu of spiritual opportunities for us in these coming days. We pray that God's blessing will remain upon us all as we pray in this most unique time with confidence and trust in God's all-powerful love and care for us. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please join in singing in our closing hymn, All Glory, Laud, and Honor.
Sweet Hosanna.
celebrate.